Well, hello again and welcome to another episode of the Hyperion Adventures Podcast. I'm Tom. As always, I'm with my gorgeous, wonderful, intelligent, extremely hardworking Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival loving wife and co-host, Michelle.
Thank you, sweetie. Hi, everybody.
So good to have you with us. We are recording this episode on Sunday, March 6th, 2022. Yes, I am back from the trip. It's a new show. Not that the other ones weren't new, but they weren't like delayed by a couple weeks.
Right. And you know, we're back to a regular routine of doing Well, I mean, I'm just saying of the Sunday recording. Right. So that's cool.
Yes. This is going to be a lot of fun today. I'm looking forward to talking about the stuff we're going to deal with today.
Right.
Yeah. So this will be good. And it's good to be home more than anything else.
I bet.
Yeah. So. And be with my sweetheart here and recording, our weekly fun time that we have together doing this show.
I know, it's the best.
It is the best. So anyway, it's the best that you joined us today. Thank you for joining us today. In the future, you can find us most everywhere you get podcasts. However, the very best place to find us is on our own website, HyperionAdventuresPodcast.com. And while you're there,
if you haven't already, we'd invite you to sign up for our newsletter. We don't give that email address out. We just use it to give some info to you.
Nope, just a once-a-week newsletter that we get out. This week, it was really tough for me to get it out because I've been out of the loop for a week or so. Plus, I had some other stuff that I had to kind of catch up on. But got the newsletter out to you and hope you're enjoying it. It's just another way to be involved in the Hyperion Adventures podcast world.
And you do a great job.
No, thank you. I appreciate it. It's quirky. It's funky. It's the Hyperion Adventures podcast. Newsletter. Also, another great way to be in touch with us is through social media. We have a lot of fun with a lot of you out there on social media. We're on Twitter at Hyperion Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, and Pinterest, although I don't know how much we've been doing on Pinterest lately, but we are still there at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. If you are on Facebook, come on over and join us in our fun little Hyperion Adventurers Facebook group.
Yeah, it is a great group, and we appreciate everybody's positivity and sharing, and that's fun. And I love your little subtle hint about Michelle, get on that Pinterest part.
Subtle. I didn't think it was subtle at all.
All right.
I know. I get it. It's tough for me to get things out on social media as well. And Pinterest, I mean, I could help on Pinterest, but I can't really help on Pinterest because I barely understand Pinterest. So that's why it's all on your shoulder. So I get it. As I said, she's super hardworking. It's tough for her to get to everything that we do, but I'm sure that, you know, when she gets the chance.
It's funny because, you know, I'm like, my attention kind of goes in cycles. So like for a while I'll be like really hot and heavy into being involved in Twitter, and then I'll shift to Facebook, you know, and may have ignored one or the other for, you know, days or whatever. And so it's just getting back into that.
Plus you have Disney planning and stuff to do. You have all your research that you do. It's tough. I mean, you, along with your work that is really, really hard and takes up a lot of your time every single week, to get the stuff that you do for the show together. I mean, I think you could be completely forgiven for not getting to some of the social media from time to time. So now me, I have no excuse. You definitely do.
No. We both are busy. Thank you.
We are also on YouTube. If you want to find us there, do a quick search for Hyperion Adventures Podcast. Hit subscribe. You'll know whenever we have a new video. And if you ever want to contact us for any reason, please hit us up at our Gmail account, HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com.
We definitely love hearing from you. So if you feel like shouting out to us or whatever through email or asking us a question, whatever, or just saying hi. Yeah. We love those emails too.
Topic suggestions, suggestions for our Spreadshirt shop. I know Scott in Minnesota sent us out an idea within the last couple of weeks that Scott, I hear you. And I'm thinking about trying to do something along that when we can find the time to get to work on that, because it's a development thing, but we're not going to give it out yet. But there is something that may be in the works, and I appreciate the idea, Scott. Thank you very much. So speaking of that Spreadshirt shop, it's a great way to help support this show. We have lots of different logos, lots of different types of gear. Yes, shirts, of course, but hats, mugs, water bottles, face masks, all sorts of stuff. If you want to find us there, just go to Spreadshirt.com and do a search for us. It's also on our Linktree account that you can find a link directly to our shop. And again, we get a portion of everything that's purchased there. And it's just a you get some great swag, and it's a great help to us as a show.
Right. We really appreciate it.
Yes, we very much appreciate it. We had a couple new purchases this week. Yay. Within the shop. So thank you very much for that. Another great way is through our Patreon page. If you want to find us there, just go to patreon.com/Hyperion Adventures Podcast. We have tiers starting as low as $2 per month. You get some swag out of it. We got some other stuff coming up as soon as next week, as a matter of fact. Just if you want to be involved in that way, that's another great way to help support the show.
Yeah, we really appreciate it. And, you know, we love doing the show. There are costs associated with it. And so anything that people send our way is very much appreciated.
Very much appreciated. Thank you for everything that you do. Thank you for all your input. And yeah, if you support us in one way or shape or form, even just a review is a great way to support this
Definitely.
Show.
Definitely. Yeah.
So now we this is the time in the show where we'd like to try and get to the positives of the week that was. You know, every week is a little tricky. This week is really weird with what's going on in the world right now. A lot of weirdness happening out there, a lot of negativity out there. But we always find that there's some sort of positivity to take out of each and every week. And we like to share that on this show. We like to share our favorite things from the week and some of your favorite things from the week that was as well. And when we do this, we always start with Michelle because, as I mentioned, she does the best research. She has the best list, as you'll find out in a little bit. She does definitely the best tips, but she also usually has the best favorite thing from this week. So, Michelle, what was your favorite thing from this week?
Mine is an easy one. My favorite thing of this week is that you and Scott made it back here safe and sound, and we're all together again, and that's awesome.
Yeah, that is my favorite thing also from this week was was getting back home and getting to see your smiling face after a week away, getting off the road. I was on the road for almost the entire week last week, heading from one coast to the other back and forth. And had a really nice trip with Scott back here. And it just worked out really, really well. But mostly getting a big hug from you, getting to sit down with you and having a nice evening again. It was definitely my favorite thing from this week.
Aw, thank you. Likewise, sweetie.
So, one other thing I want to mention just as a favorite thing from this week is we finally caught on Disney Plus Free Guy, the movie Free Guy, which we really enjoyed. It wasn't like this great award-winning deep thinker of a movie, but it was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
You know, it was just kind of a goofy, fun movie.
Yeah, totally entertaining and, you know, had some elements of suspense to it that you didn't really know which way it was going to go. So, yeah, loved it.
And as a person who likes video games, and maybe not the, you know, first-person shooters is like that was game was supposed to be kind of presenting.
Right.
That's not really my thing. But I do like video games, so I like a lot of the nods to many video games that are out there. So it just was an enjoyable, enjoyable movie. We did also get a favorite thing from this week from one of our Hyperion Adventurers in our Hyperion Adventurer Facebook group, and that was Tony, the Disney dad. He sent this out on Thursday. He said, the best thing for me this week hasn't happened yet, but the surprise boys trip to Galaxy's Edge starts tomorrow. So it actually has already happened. He sent that on Thursday. Friday was when the trip apparently started. We can't wait to see pictures from that.
Know.
Tony, please be sure and post them on our Hyperion Adventurers Facebook group. Anyway, he went on to say, we told the boys about the trip on Sunday and they were shocked. We will be eating and bowling at Splitsville in Disney Springs tomorrow. So that was Friday night. My son Stitch has been wanting to go bowling for a while. So why not start off the trip with it? So that's a lot of fun.
So awesome.
It's going to be their first trip, all of them to Galaxy's Edge. So that's going to be very exciting. Because I know they're all big Star Wars fans.
Right, well deserved. Tony and his family are super special people. They do amazing things, and they really deserve all the best because they are people you want to be like.
Yeah. So Tony, Sparrow, Stitch, the whole family, I'm so glad that you're having a good time, or I assume you're having a good time out there at Disney. We can't wait to hear all about your surprise trip.
Yeah, and thank you for letting us share in your excitement, because we love that.
Right. So that's it for looking back at the week that was. Let's get into this week's show. We have lots of stuff for you this week, including if you love Disney Plus but are not crazy about the price of it, well, we have some good news for you. If you have little ones at home that are big fans of Disney Junior, well, there's a Disneyland event coming in the near future that you're going to want to know about. And if you have a Disney cruise on the horizon, there's a key change to their COVID policy that you'll want to be aware of. We'll tell you about that as well. But enough about all that. Let's go ahead and get to our main topic of the week. main topic this week. Well, it just kicked off on Friday, as a matter of fact. That is the Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival, the 2022 version. Mm-hmm. The last time we really talked about this on the show was the 2020 version. However, like a couple weeks after that one began, something happened in the world that kind of cut that one off quickly.
Oh, I know. It's crazy to think back of that. We, first of all, were able to experience a preview night for that one before the official opening.
And yeah, then, we were there for the soft opening, essentially.
Right, right. Yeah. And, you know, got to taste a few things, but we know we were holding back some other dishes that we thought we'd be tasting again in the near future. We had still some of our tags left on our,
on our sip and saver pass.
Right. Yeah. So,
yeah. So it was a little bit weird. And then they haven't obviously had it again. Disneyland just reopened. They had some sort of little thing, you know, that they held there, even though Disneyland hadn't reopened at that point. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't the same. Finally, this year, we're back. The Food and Wine Festival is back. And everybody knows about the Epcot International Food and Wine Festival, mm-hmm. and how popular that's become. And I tell you what, while the Disneyland version isn't as big as that one, it is a pretty cool festival and something, if you get a chance to get out to the West Coast, or if you live out here on the West Coast, you'll definitely want to check out.
Definitely. Just definitely. Like you were saying, definitely. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think one of the nice things on the West Coast version is because, you know, California is wine country, USA, that they really do tap into that resource, into some of their programs and, you know, the whole kind of influence of the Food and Wine Festival here. Plus, West Coast is getting bigger and bigger with microbreweries, and that's also included in this. So I think there's a lot of great elements in the West Coast that they can put into this program to make this festival really special.
Yeah, it's always one of our favorite times of year, and we always look forward to it. It's so much fun, and definitely a reason to get out to Disney California Adventure Park, among the many reasons, mm-hmm. but we really love this per se. By the way, I meant to mention this when we were talking about what today's date was when we were recording this episode early on, but how I mentioned that we visited and then it shut down for the pandemic. Today is also the date of we sailed away from New Orleans, mm-hmm. on our Panama Canal cruise where everything
Clueless.
Went crazy. The world entirely changed while we were in the middle of that 2-week cruise.
Yeah. It's amazing that within 2 weeks, things change so dramatically.
Right. If you haven't heard that episode, go back and listen to it from a couple years ago. Well, as soon as we got off the ship, we talked all about our experiences and it was something. But anyway, I digress. I just wanted to bring that up before I forgot that that this was a kind of a special anniversary date for us. So moving back to our main topic. There are a lot of different places where you can get the various dishes from the Food and Wine Festival. There's all sorts of events. There's wine tastings, mm-hmm. beer tastings. There's winemaker dinners, all sorts of things going on. We've talked about it in the past, and there's a lot of stuff going on out there. But the big thing to do and just go out there and enjoy is the food at the various different locations. They have different kiosks, different little kitchens, marketplaces, essentially, that put out different dishes, mm-hmm. and cocktails. But they also have them at a lot of the quick service restaurants as well.
Right. Yeah. Some of them you can even do mobile ordering.
Yes. So that kind of makes things a lot easier. And we're not going to talk about everything that's going on today, but we are going to talk about some of the must-try dishes that when we get out there, hopefully sometime within the next few weeks, we have some reservations, mm-hmm. for out there at the parks, hoping to make it work, that we're going to get out there and sample a lot of these things. Before I get into what we're going to sample, we're going to do a top 5 list of the 5 things we want to, mm-hmm. sample, the must-try things. I wanted to go over some of the marketplaces and tell you what they're all about in case you're planning on going out there. You want to do your research going out there because there's so much good food to try.
Right.
You're going to want to check out for sure. So these are the marketplaces that they have right now. And a lot of them are going to sound familiar because they're kind of repeats of what they've had over many years. But here they are. Avocado Time, which they say indulge in the flavorful medleys that make your mouth sing. Mm-hmm. There, of course, a lot of it based on avocado.
Right.
Berry patch where they say, hail the big berry for top billing. Yes. California craft brews, we talked about, as Michelle meant, the microbreweries, the craft brews, very famous here in California. So that's a great place to try a lot of craft brews. Right. There's Cluck-a-Doodle Moo, which is, you know, they have a lot of different wings and sliders. And you know, so it's obviously you think about it. There's chicken, there's beef. Cluck-a-Doodle Moo. Yes, for sure. There's Delish, which is, they say, enjoy sweet and savory dishes, sure to delight. Delish. Garlic Kissed, which is a great place. Of course, dishes that are focused on garlic. Oh, it's so good. Yeah, Golden Dreams, which they say they have lots of well-seasoned dishes and nectarous drinks. So a lot of, you know, Golden Dreams, very much California and very much like California Adventure Park, especially early on. Right. There's a lot of golden involved with that. I Heart Artichokes. Obviously, you know what that one's about.
Right.
Nuts and Cheese, again, speaks for itself. Right. Peppers Caliente, Cali, as in California, Ente as well. Where you can get a lot of spicy fare. Yeah, there. And Uncorked California, where they focus on a lot of the California wines there. So those are all the kiosks. But you can also get food, as I mentioned before, at a lot of the quick service restaurants where they have specialty dishes that are focused around the food and wine festival as well.
Right. Yeah. Some of the, like you said, some a couple of their regular, always there restaurants have, they'll say seasonal. But what it is sometimes it's one of their featured items for the season that they also can do in a small plate version for the festival.
Mm-hmm. And they also have some of the table service restaurants as well, like Lamplight Lounge has some specialty dishes there that is just for the Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival as well. So.
And they also include Downtown Disney for for dishes and drinks that you can sample during the festival.
Right. You don't have to go even pay admission. All you have to do is get down to the Downtown Disney district, and there are lots of things to sample there as well. They've opened it up not only to a lot of the restaurants around there, but even to some of the hotels as well. So you can pop in and just kind of cruise around there and not have to feel about you're paying admission or get a reservation.
That's true. Yeah. That's true.
So, because reservations can be a little tricky sometimes.
Right.
So even if you can't land a reservation for the day that you have off or the day that you have availability to visit, you can just go ahead and head down to the Downtown Disney District and enjoy some of the fun food and fare there.
So true.
Yeah. And they are offering the Sip and Savor Pass again this year, which is we will recommend every single time if you're planning on getting several dishes or if you're going to be going multiple times. It is well worth it. This year, it's $57 for 8 tabs. You can use one tab for the various different plates. Can't use it for alcohol, but a lot of different food. And that includes a lot of the food at the quick service places as well, not just the marketplace. There are also discounts if you are a Magic Key holder or a Disney Visa Rewards member. So look into that so you can save a few more dollars. For $57 for 8 tabs, basically if you're averaging buying dishes that are $7.25 or more, you're saving money.
Right, right.
Over
and,
it.
Right. And they do have dishes I was looking that, you know, they range. They have some that are also less than that. So you wouldn't want to use your tab for something less if you're
You can. You can use your tab for whatever you want.
Right.
But if you want to save money, you want to have more of the higher end dishes that you're the higher cost dishes that you're using for your tabs.
Right. So they do have some dishes that are either $8, anywhere from $8 to $8.50, $8.50.
Yeah,
so if you were doing all, you know, did all 8 tabs at $8.50 each, then you're going to really save some money.
Yeah, you're going to save a lot of money.
Yeah.
Especially if you use your discount as well. If you're if you're a Magic Key holder or a Disney Visa Rewards member as well. So we're going to go ahead and count down with the things that we're most excited for. We went through the whole foodie guide. We picked out the things that we want to sample when we get out there to the Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival. So we're going to give you, as always, one of our Hyperion Adventurers' 5 favorite lists. Whether it'll be only 5, we'll see. Tend to not be, but you never know. But whenever we do a list like this, we always start with Michelle. One, because she is awesome, wonderful, all things good in the world. She does the best research. She definitely has the very best tips, but she also has the best list. So let's get to it. Michelle, what is your 5th favorite thing that you can't wait to try, your must try from the Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival?
All right. So I have a lot of explanation.
Oh, boy. Of course you do.
Well, first of all, before I get into my list, one of the things I was just thinking of that we didn't mention is one of the really one of my most favorite things about Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival and all the festivals that they have Disney California Adventure Park is that you can pay for all the dishes you want at one kiosk. So go into one line to pay. You can look for the shortest line. It doesn't have to, you might not even be getting any food from that particular kiosk. Order, you know, as many dishes as you want, and then just take your receipt to pick up the food at each of the kiosks. And it just saves a lot of time from, you know, being in essence, two queues, the queue to pay and then the queue to get your food. So that's a real plus, I think, at Disney California Adventure Park. So I actually, for my top five, I went through different variations of how I did this. So it's not really like 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. It's just kind of, I was thinking in terms of if I was eating the food, like what order, like how would I build up to the food? Maybe like if it was a 5-course meal kind of concept.
Well, hey, you do your five however you want to do your five. I just listed my five from 5 to 1, yeah. But you can do whatever you want.
I just don't want people to think that my number five is like, oh, that's her least favorite. It's just more the process.
Gotcha.
I stuck to five. I had like one, we'll get into it, but I also wanted to include one thing with in terms of beverage. I didn't include 5 beverages. But what I did see this time, and well, the other thing to say about my selections is they're all new dishes.
Okay.
I didn't go to any repeats. Not that I wouldn't try them. Not that they're great, but I thought the new ones sound spectacular.
Right. Well, let's see. We'll see how many we have that are matchy-matchy here,
right,
because we may
right.
have a few. So let's go ahead and go through the list. What's your number five?
Okay.
Or your first dish, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah. For the alcohol, that just to put it out there, or drinks, beverage, is they have a tropical mimosa flight, and that's at the Uncorked California kiosk. And so they have 3 different mimosas. I know that we love the mimosa flight at Lamplight Lounge. These are different. So if you've had Lamplight, these are not the same. So one is a green apple and lychee mimosa. Mm. Sounds really good. The next one is a passion fruit and banana mimosa.
Interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought, how'd they get that banana flavoring? And the next one is a cherry, yuzu, and ginger mimosa. So those sound lovely.
Kind of an Asian-inspired mimosa there.
Yeah. Yeah. You can get any of those mimosas as an individual. Like if one of them really calls out to you, you can get them individually, but they do have the flight with the 3 of them.
Nice.
Thank you.
Is that your first dish or is that just an extra?
That's just an extra beverage.
We just got to start off right. It's the Food and Wine Festival. We got to start off with a little, you know, glug glug.
Wine.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Made from grapes. Yes. So, all right. So I guess now.
Yes, wine is made from grapes, honey. Thank you.
Champagne. Yeah. All right. So here's my first dish. It's called the Next Level Cracker and Cheese. And it comes from the kiosk Nuts About Cheese. And it's a house-made herb cracker with white cheddar-infused fromage blanc, spicy prosciutto spread, and cherry jam. This one is one of the higher-priced ones. It's at $8. The one thing about this is the cheese is more of a soft, creamy kind of cheese. It's not like think of slicing cheese or cheese chunks or anything like that. It's more, think of the consistency more like a thick cream cheese kind of. And it, to me, it's cute because it also looks like a giant s'more.
Yeah, I was going to ask you if that's the one that looks like the kind of like a panini almost, but yeah, s'more
right,
is almost
right.
a better
yeah, yeah,
call
top
for
and bottom.
Yeah.
Yeah, top and bottom kind of like, because it's kind of sandwichy looking.
Right.
Yeah.
Very cool. Yeah, I thought about that one. That's a good choice.
Thank
I like that
you.
One. Very
Thank
good.
Thank you.
I'd like to check that one out.
Okay, what about your number five?
My number five is the Euro-inspired flatbread featuring impossible ground beef from L.A. Style. Yeah.
That almost made it. I think I was just checking my list. I was like, did I take that off? Because I thought I did. But yeah, that one almost made mine too.
Which I don't think I mentioned, but that was another, somehow I skipped over that in the marketplaces. L.A. Style is like a food truck based marketplace that's out there. So anyway, it's a little less expensive, so you may not want to spend your tabs on it if you have a Sip and Saver pass, although it's not crazy to go under. It's $6.75 for it, but it has chipotle hummus, tzatziki, and spiced crispy chickpeas along with the impossible ground beef on the gyro. It mm-hmm. sounds delicious. I love gyros. I love tzatziki. I love that whole flavor profile.
Right.
This sounds fascinating to me, and I'd love to check it out.
Yeah, and the fact that it's like a flatbread mm-hmm. kind of format to it.
Right.
It kind of makes it a little more unique too.
Yeah. So that's definitely on my plate of things that, literally my plate of things that I want to try once we get out there to Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival. Yeah. We'll have to see. Yeah. So that's my number five. Let's get to Michelle's next dish, or number four, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Her next dish that is a must try from the Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival.
Okay. So still kind of in the area of appetizers, I guess, is a chicharron crusted fried artichoke dip. And that's from obviously I Heart Artichokes kiosk there. And it says it's served with smoked pepper crema. And I'm not good at pronouncing this cheese.
Oaxaca?
Yeah. And Oaxaca cheese. Make me sound smart.
Yes. Very nice. Oaxaca cheese.
Yeah. And this one also, like you said, it is with your dish, it's not the higher priced one. So this might be one that you would just pay cash if you or whatever, you know. But anyways, I picked it because who doesn't like artichoke dip anyways? And then you find a way to fry it.
Yes. So
it's like carnival food, right? It just screams out, yum.
Yeah, it looks festival. Great too. It was on my honorable mentions. It didn't make my list, but right. Nearly did.
Yeah.
I had it on there as a possibility for sure because yeah. It looks great.
I mean, it's like the serving is like two very large, think of like large meatballs on top of this smoked pepper crema. But it just, again, looks delicious, sounds delicious.
Does look delicious, yeah. And I'm looking forward to trying that. So.
Yeah, so we're at your number four.
My number four is, and we're going away from the marketplaces here and over to the Paradise Garden Grill, and that is for the brisket fries.
Mm.
And on my recent road trip, I had some really good brisket on the way. And so I'm kind of like, yeah, I got a feeling for brisket right now. And this one is French fries topped with shredded smoked barbecue brisket, cheddar cheese sauce, pico de gallo, chipotle crema, and green onion. So it's not only is it brisket, and it's also a little bit of kind of that Latin flavor mm-hmm. involved there, you
right.
know. So you get a little you get a little barbecue, you know, you get a little Southwestern right. or Mexican, whatever you want to call it there, on top of French fries, which, okay, always good. So mm-hmm. that is something that definitely calls out to me as something I'd want to try for
yeah.
this Food and Wine Festival.
When I saw it on the menu, I thought you're probably going to pick that one.
Mm-hmm.
It does seem like something that would call out to you.
And I don't have a price on that one. I don't know if you got a price on it, but unfortunately, in the food guide, they didn't have a price. Some of these I have a price for, some I don't. But either way, that looked good for me, and I don't care what the price is. I'm going to try.
There you go.
So that's my number four. Michelle, what is your number three, or the next dish that's your must-try dish from the Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival?
Progressing to the soup course.
Yes. We're so ritzy here.
I know, right? So this one is at the Golden Dreams kiosk there, and it's a mango carrot gazpacho with grilled shrimp and jalapeno crema. And this one is more of the $8.25, so this one I would use a tab for mm-hmm. sure. But I mean, it sounds so delightful. I mean, thinking of, you know, springtime and everything, having a nice chilled soup that but incorporates both a vegetable and a fruit so that you get that nice blend together. And the shrimp sounds magnificent.
Yeah, that was another honorable mention. I was looking at that. I'm like, that looks pretty good and refreshing, especially if it's a warmer day. It's a gazpacho, so
right.
it's chilled. That sounds really nice on a, like I said, a hot day.
Right. I mean, I've had chilled carrot soup before, but this, like I said, having the mango in it as well, and how they have it topped with, you know, the shrimp, you see, you get a little different consistency in mm-hmm. what you're eating for that gazpacho.
Very good.
Yeah.
Good choice.
Thank you.
Good choice.
So you're number three.
My number three, I'm going back to the marketplaces, and this one I'm going to California Craft Brews for, and that is the IPA sausage dog. I mean, that looks really, really good
does.
To me. It's only $7. So again, borderline on whether you want to use a tab for it. It's just a little under what break-even point is.
Right.
If you have a discount, then you're good. You can mm-hmm. use your tabs on this, but borderline on it. So they say it comes on a soft pretzel roll with onion, pepper, jardiniere, which is it's kind of a pickled vegetable type mm-hmm. thing. So it's the onions and peppered or pickled is what that is. With cheddar cheese sauce. And apparently I want cheese sauce on it. And a malt vinegar jalapeno crunch. So a little bit of spice to this, a little bit of sour, a little acid, you know, the meatiness of it, the cheese to kind of cool right. it down. Sounds delicious. And, you know, I'm not a huge hot dog person, mm-hmm. but if there's a hot dog I'm going to try, it's probably going to be this one.
Yeah. And it looks delicious. I'll give you that. It really does look like it's, and it looks like a nice full size dish to try.
Like right. You can split this up between, it looks like you can split it up between two people. Yeah, and yeah. for that $7, you're getting value out
right,
of it.
Right. Exactly. Know? Exactly.
So that's my third dish that is a must try from the Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival. Let's get to Michelle's next course that she's going to try.
So here's one, I guess it could have been, you know, because it's also a soup, but this one is not a cold soup, and it's from the Sonoma Terrace. So that's one of the already existing restaurants that mm-hmm. are there, but that they're offering some specialty dishes for the festival. And it's called the Old World Aged White Cheddar Lager Soup with Toasted Fig and Prosciutto Sandwich. Mm-hmm. So you think of like that soup and sandwich, you know, it's just like a you know, cup of soup, you know, and what would be equivalent to like a half a sandwich. But I thought, what a great blend of having, you know, first of all, a cheddar lager soup, I think we all know is usually very tasty.
Cheesy and rich.
Right,
and
right.
Delicious, yeah.
And then accompanying it with that fig in mm-hmm. the sandwich and the prosciutto with the saltiness, it just sounds yeah. like all those flavors.
A little salty, you break it all up. There. Right,
right. right. So this one's at $7.50. So again, it you know, if you're using tabs and trying to calculate if that's a good value for you, it's, you know, just above that break even mm-hmm. or a little bit better. So it's definitely one that you might want to consider using your tab
for sure. So that's a great choice. I love that one.
Thank
nice.
you.
Nice. On to my number two, mm-hmm. and we're going over, this is one that unfortunately Michelle and I may not be smooching after we sample this one, because it's over from the Garlic Kissed Marketplace, and that is the Carbonara Garlic Mac and Cheese mm. from Garlic right. Kissed at $8. It comes with peppered bacon mm-hmm. and that is right up my alley. You got the garlic in there. You right. get the bacon. Carbonara style, which I'm surprised Michelle hasn't mentioned that yet, or maybe that's her number one. I don't know, because she loves carbonara in general. So you throw it and make it kind of a mac and cheese to kind of have it more accessible for most people.
Right.
And this is one that calls out to me for sure.
So yeah, that one almost made my list. And you're right. I love carbonara. It's one of my most favorite styles of having pasta. And I especially love having it with like a Chenin Blanc to accompany it. I think it really offsets it really nicely. I think the only reason I didn't pick it was it wasn't new. But that was one of those dishes that I had wanted to try in the past that we didn't get to.
Didn't get
that
around to it. Postponed. Thought we'd have another chance yes. and didn't get one.
But yeah, it definitely sounds delicious. And I love how they had the bacon accompanying it. And mm-hmm. and I like how it's kind of served separate so you can, you know, mix in, blend in as much as you want mm-hmm. with each bite. So you have a little bit of control in that regards as well.
Right. And at $8, again, mm-hmm. If you're looking for the discount on the Sip and Saver, right. Sip and Saver Pass, that's a perfect dish for that. So
most definitely.
Very good. So that is my number two. Let's finally get to the final course for Michelle's must-try dishes from the Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival.
All right. So I actually do have an A or B because it would depend on how I felt that day. But both of them do involve seafood. So my first number one, I guess you would say, 1A, is a beer-battered fish taco. That comes from the Paradise Garden Grill. So what's really nice about that's one that you can mobile order. But that's got a Baja-style beer-battered fish on corn tortillas, and it's topped with slaw, pico de gallo, cilantro crema, and they also serve it with house-made tortilla chips and a roasted red chili tomato salsa. So I thought, I mean, that just kind of screams Southern California, mm-hmm. you know, a fish taco, and love a great fish taco.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that sounds great.
Mm-hmm. And my 1B, I guess, if I wasn't going to get that seafood dish would be from Golden Dreams. Again, another dish from Golden Dreams is their honey orange glazed salmon salad with citrus vinaigrette. That's an $8 fee for that one. So again, really good value for the tab. And that one, I mean, I do love how they do. I've been very pleased with the salmon dishes I've tried at different Disney festivals. You know, this one's kind of, in terms of a salad, simple, that is served on green, just kind of placed on greens. But to have that honey orange glaze will be magnificent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that sounds really good. I'm always a big fan of salmon, so that sounds like a wonderful dish as well. And did think about putting it on my list, but didn't quite make it. But I'm glad it made yours.
Thank you.
So we can talk about it.
Yeah. Here. All right. So now the pièce de résistance, your number one.
Right. And I'm really surprised that this wasn't anywhere on your list. I thought sure this was going to be a matchy match. It's surprised that we didn't have any matchy matches on our list this time. So I'm going away from the marketplaces for my number one and going to one of the quick service restaurant. So again, you can mobile order this.
Right.
It's from the Lucky Fortune Cookery, and that is the mushroom bao from that. With hoisin glazed mushroom. So that's kind of like an Asian barbecue sauce, if you don't know what hoisin is. With Asian slaw and jalapeno in a steamed bao. And it looks delicious. Everything about it calls out to me.
Right.
Those are all my flavor profiles right there. That is a dish that I am very excited to try.
Oh, most definitely. And I would too. And it was kind of hard not to include that on there. They actually had another dish at that same kiosk or same quick service that also sound good with their ribs. So yeah, that one, it was like, ooh, there's two good dishes. Hard to choose, but
especially when you can mobile order there, and you can use the tabs on those as well. So just to let you know, I don't know if it's still tricky with mobile ordering using the tabs, but if you want to mobile order them, you can do that at those sites are the quick service sites.
Right. And when, you know, when you're using the app or even the little guides that they give you, they tell you which ones you can mobile order as well. So it's handy. But yeah, so I know the bao sounds really, really good for sure.
Did you have any other dishes that are kind of like honorable mentions that you might want to put out there?
You know, I was trying to figure out some dessert type of dishes and, you know, It's hard because there are so many great desserts already at Disney California Adventure Park. And I know we tend to always go to Pim's Kitchen for a dessert there.
Choco Smash Bar.
Right. At the festival, they have something similar with a Snickers macaroon that also has a nice ganache to it with it. And that sounded really yummy. I know you're not a fan of cotton candy. I am. They have this year berry cotton candy, so that sounded pretty interesting.
That's such a whatever to me. But I know people love cotton candy. Cotton candy doesn't do anything for me, but I get it.
I think more of my honorable mentions are some of the ones that you included, like the carbonara and the bao would be some of mine. What about you?
Yeah, I have three here to fill out my eight tabs on my Sip and Savor Pass. I have three more, and these were all definitely would be worthy of using a tab on because they're all $8.25 or more.
Okay.
I'm going to start with, and this may be a new Disney Dishes blog dish. I might try and recreate this once I get a taste of it to see what it's all about. And that is from the Delish Marketplace. It's the black and tan beef potato puffs. So basically tots.
Right.
And I love tots. So this goes for $8.50 and it has a Carl Strauss Brewing Company Rec Alley Stout gravy on top of this beef on these potato puffs, tots, and light lager micro sponge. So Carl Strauss Brewery, actually a San Diego brewery down here that's been around for, they were doing craft beers years ago. They're a little bit bigger than that now, but that is very interesting to me. I love meat and things on tots.
I know.
It's just one of my favorite things in the world. This is something we talk about, a stout gravy.
Right.
It's right up my alley.
Yeah, no, it sounds delicious. And I thought about that one too. I think caloric wise, I was just like, oh, maybe
calories, whatever. They don't count when you're in the parks.
I'm sure. Yes, no.
Especially for the Food and Wine Festival. Calories, you don't count.
That's true.
You don't count. Speaking of calories don't count, how about the chili relleno empanada from the Peppers Caliente Marketplace? Again, $8.50, so a real bargain if you have the Sip and Savor Pass, with Arbor Pepper Salsa featuring Oaxaca and Cotija cheeses. So that also sounds delicious.
wonder how hot the hot is over at Caliente.
Yeah, well, it's Caliente. Might be a little spicy for you. I might have to take a bite of it and tell you whether or not you could,
if
you don't want any of this. This is too spicy for you. No, you don't want any of it.
No sharing. Yeah. I hear you.
Finally, again, something that we won't be smooching after because, again, it's from Garlic Kissed, and that is the grilled top sirloin with rusted garlic, Gruyere smashed potatoes, mm-hmm. and black garlic chimichurri with black garlic. It's kind of an aged garlic that gives it almost a balsamic vinegar type flavor profile to it. Love black garlic, mm-hmm. and love chimichurri. So that's $8.25. Again, well within that discount for your Sip and Savor pass. Yes. And that's another dish that I would look forward to trying.
Yeah, that might be a good one to try for Disney, to recreate for Disney dishes too.
Yeah, possibly. And once I get to sample it and get the flavor profile down, I may give it a shot.
So. Nice.
Yeah, so those are all the dishes that we're excited to try at the Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival. We'd love to know if you've been out there yet. Have you tried something? Is there something that you can't wait to try? Let us know and we'll share it on an upcoming show.
Yeah.
Or maybe we'll try it.
That's right. Maybe we'll test it for you.
Yeah, and if there's any of these dishes, by the way, that I've mentioned here, that I've mentioned a couple that I may be trying to recreate for the Disney Dishes blog, if there's one of them that you'd really like me to try and recreate because maybe you can't make it out there, or you just want to know how to make it in your own kitchen, let me know. I'm always happy to take recommendations on dishes to create for the Disney Dishes blog.
Good deal.
So that is our look at the must-tries from the 2022 Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival. That was a lot of fun. I can't wait to go back to Disney California Adventure Park just for the Food and Wine Festival. It's always one of our favorite things every year. All that great food and more and all the great drinks. Can't wait to try it out.
I know. It looks like they really outdid themselves this year. So that's awesome.
So if it is that time of year, it's also the time of year for madness. Whoa. As you know, we put out our brackets out there for you to return to us to pick out who is going to win our Disney Songs Madness that Michelle put together.
I know. It's been great, one, getting all the responses back, but also getting some feedback. And I think being our first bracket, we're learning things in terms of maybe making it a little challenging by having some songs that might not be as much in the forefront of people's mind. So thank you, people, for giving us that feedback. That's really helpful so that when we make our next bracket, it can feel a little bit more enjoyable at times.
Well, I think people enjoyed it just the same. And we got plenty of brackets back. And by the way, as I mentioned many times in the previous shows, the people that bring their brackets in, your picks are what chooses who wins each round, who advances, who will be our eventual champion. And today,
although I really thought it should have been just my picks.
Yeah, I know you did. It's not. It's not. It's everybody's. And by the way, again, the person that gets the most correct picks right will win that gift pack, including that Castaway Club crossbody bag and the Castaway Club luggage tags and some other different logo gear that we have and stuff.
So yeah, I don't know that you highlighted, but we opened the vault that actually there's a very collectible item in there.
Ooh, so that's going to be a lot of fun for the one winner out of this group. So we're going to go through every week and kind of give you the winners of each round. And well, of course, this was the first round. Mm-hmm. We just had the cut it off. This week is when you could get your brackets in. Again, thank you to everybody who got their brackets into us. And let's see how you did through the first round. So get your brackets out and follow along and let's see who you pick. So we'll start off with the first matchup in the classic songs category in animated films. And that was the one seed versus the eighth seed. And easy for me to say, When You Wish Upon a Star versus Someday My Prince Will Come. Michelle, who did you pick in that one?
I put When You Wish Upon a Star. It was a hard one, but I picked that one.
That's who I picked as well, and that's who won. The one seed prevails in that one. When You Wish Upon a Star moves on to the second round. They will face off against the winner of Bella Notte versus Hakuna Matata. Michelle, who did you pick?
I picked Bella Notte. The romantic.
I picked the winner. Hakuna Matata moves on. the fifth seed advances to face the one seed in the second round. And we'll give you again the results of that one next week. Moving on to the next one, the three seed versus the six seed, Be Our Guest versus Bare Necessities. Michelle, who did you pick in that round?
That was kind of tough for me, but I picked Bare Necessities. I think just the day that I did my brackets, that's what I was kind of in the mode of thinking.
I gotcha.
What about you?
I once again picked the winner. I picked Be Our Guest, which moved on to the next round. The three
I'm
seed.
I'm seeing a trend.
I did not do that. I did not. As you'll see later, because there are several picks that I made that did not advance. So just let you know. But that is who's moving on to the next one. They will square off against the two seed or the seventh seed between A Dream Is a Wish Your Heart Makes or Cruella De Vil. Michelle, who did you pick?
A Dream Is a Wish Your Heart Makes.
And that's who prevailed. The two seed, that's who I picked as well. Dream Is a Wish Your Heart Makes has moved on to the second round to square off against Be Our Guest. Moving on to the live action films portion of this bracket. Start with the one seed versus the eighth seed, the Stay Awake from Mary Poppins, the lullaby, of course, the anti-lullaby lullaby.
Yes.
Versus the Ballad of Davy Crockett. Michelle, who did you pick there?
Yeah, the ballad. No, I picked Stay Awake.
Stay Awake is the winner. Stay Awake, the one seed again, prevails. They will go into the second round. That is who I picked as well. Going up against what I have a feeling is going to be a very tough matchup in the second round. It was either Rainbow Connection, the four seed, or Aquarela do Brasil, the number five seed. Michelle, who did you pick there?
I think I picked probably what is the winner. Although it was a tough one, I picked Rainbow Connection.
Rainbow Connection is who I picked as well, and that is who will move on.
I think this was one of those a lot of people might not have been as familiar with the other song. Although it's a great song.
It is a great song, but so is Rainbow Connection. That's Connection was the higher ranked, and deservedly so. He will go up against Stay Awake, the number one seed, and that will be an interesting matchup for sure. Moving on, for the three seed versus the six seed, Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious versus the Age of Not Believing. Michelle, who did you pick?
Again, I went sentimental, Age of Not Believing.
And I went with Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, and that is what's won. That is the third seed, and that is what will advance.
Yeah, I didn't think I had a lot of chance with this one, although it's a great song.
It is a great song. I don't disagree with that. It is a great song. Just going up against a powerhouse in Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. We will go on to face either Jolly Holiday, the two seed, or Whale of a Tale, the seventh seed. Michelle, who did you pick?
Jolly Holiday.
Yes, and Jolly Holiday won. That's who I pick as well. The 2-seed Jolly Holiday advances to go up against Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious in the next round. Now on to the fun songs category, starting with the animated side of the bracket. The number 1-seed, We Don't Talk About Bruno, no, versus a really tough matchup in an 8-seed of A Whole New World. Michelle, who did you pick?
I did go with the Encanto song of We Don't Talk About Bruno.
As did I, because I love hashtag real men love Encanto. Yes, I went with that as well, but it was a giant upset. Whoa. Maybe not really a giant upset when you know what it was going up against. The 8th seed, A Whole New World, prevailed, and that advances to the second round.
Yeah. You know, one of the things, as an aside here, we're talking about Encanto, is what's exciting, and I know you announced this recently, but just came to mind again, is how with the return of the Main Street Electrical Parade, that they're going to have a new finale float that will incorporate some newer films, and Encanto being one of them that will be represented on it.
Yeah, that was some news that came out while I was on the trip, so it was a little bit of a delayed story, so I'm not bringing it up today. But that was exciting news that they've kind of revamped a little bit at the end of the Main Street Electrical Parade. That's really cool. Yeah. Moving on, so the Whole New World will go up against the winner of the number 4 seed, Friend Like Me, versus number 5 seed, Go the Distance. Michelle, who did you pick?
Go the Distance. It just, again, that song, and we've talked about it in some of our past top 5 songs. That song has a great meaning for me, and so that I had to stick with that one. What about you?
It was a tough one for me because I love both songs so much, but I did pick Friend Like Me, and that is who ended up prevailing. Friend Like Me, the 4 seed, so that will go up against A Whole New World in the second round, a little Aladdin square off there in the second round. Moving into the next ranch, the third seed versus the sixth seed, the Sounds of the Islands in this one, the Hawaiian roller coaster ride at the third seed versus You're Welcome at the sixth seed. Michelle, who did you pick in that one?
Went a little more traditional, Hawaiian roller coaster ride.
And I picked You're Welcome, and that's who prevailed. You're Welcome. I swear I did not choose these. Otherwise, that's why we don't talk about Bruno didn't move on.
I know.
Yes.
I'm just teasing you.
Yeah, You're Welcome. The sixth seed did prevail in that one. And they will square off against the winner of the two seed versus the seventh seed, Eye to Eye versus Zero to Hero, of course, from Hercules, Eye to Eye from the a Goofy movie. Mm-hmm. Who did you pick in that one, Michelle?
Eye to Eye.
Eye to Eye, the two seed, Eye to I, that one, the two seed, and that's who I picked as well. And yes, Eye to Eye has moved on.
Yes.
So they will square off against You're Welcome in the second round. Moving to the live action films, the number one seed, Step in Time, versus the number eight seed, Chilling Like a Villain. Michelle, who did you pick in that one?
Step in Time. Just had to go with Mary Poppins' traditional song.
Great song. That's who I picked as well, and that's who won. But it was close. It was a close matchup.
I can see why. Yeah. I mean, Chilling Like a Villain's great song.
Mm-hmm. So Step in Time will go up against the winner of the fourth or fifth seed matchup here. Life is a Happy Song at the four seed versus We're All in This Together as the fifth seed. Michelle, who did you pick?
Life's a Happy Song.
Life is a Happy Song, who is who I picked as well, and that is who moves on. So that will face up against Step in Time in the second round. Next, the third seed versus the sixth seed, Once and For All from Newsies versus Rotten to the Core from the Descendants franchise. Michelle, who did you pick?
I picked Once and For All.
Yes, and that's who I picked as well, but no.
Oh.
Rotten to the Core moves on.
That
it is a great
song.
Yeah, it was tough for me. That was a tough matchup, and that was also a tough matchup for the listeners as well, the people who filled out their brackets.
Right.
It was very close. Rotten to the Core, the sixth seed, moves on, and it will go up against either Happy Little Working Song, the two seed, or Your Crowning Glory, the seventh seed. Michelle, who did you got?
Happy Little Working Song.
Yes.
I went Happy Happy.
Happy Happy, and that's who I got. Happy Little Working Song and Happy Little Working Song moves on to face Rotten to the Core in the next round. Moving to the east coast of the bracket, we'll start with the Want Songs, the animated version of the Want Songs here. And at the number one seed, it is Almost There versus hashtag Real Men Love Frozen, Let It Go, all the way down at the eighth seed. Michelle, who did you pick?
Although I'm wearing my Real Men Love Frozen t-shirt today, I did pick Almost There.
I may not be wearing my hashtag Real Men Love Frozen t-shirt, but it is always in my heart. And yes, Let It Go did advance over Almost There, but it was really, really close. It just I think mine might have pushed it over the edge because it was like a one vote difference there. So Let It Go does move on. And this is the one time that maybe my vote paid a huge part in it. So Let It Go moves on as the eighth seed over the one seed. It will square off against another tough matchup here. What was it? Number four seed, Part of Your World, or the number five seed, Do You Want to Build a Snowman? Who'd you pick, Michelle?
Again, didn't go with the Frozen this time. Went with Part of Your World.
I didn't go with Frozen this time either. I went Part of Your World too because I think it's a great Want song, and that is what advanced. Part of Your World as the number four seed advances. Moving on to the next part of the bracket, the number three seed, Reflection, versus the sixth seed, For the First Time in Forever, another Frozen song here. Michelle, who did you pick?
Actually, this one was harder for me than the other ones. And I don't want people to think I don't like Frozen. I do. But I actually, though, because of the message and everything, I still picked Reflection over.
Yeah. I love Frozen. You know that? Hashtag Real Men Love Frozen. I also picked Reflection. I think it's a better song than this one. I love For the First Time in Forever, but Reflection is the better Want song. That is what advances as the third seed. Moving on, and the Reflection will square off against the winner of the two seed, I See the Light, versus the seventh seed, When Will My Life Begin? A little Tangled battle there. Michelle, who did you pick?
Yeah, another tough one, but I went with the number two seed, I See the Light.
Yes, and that's what I went. As you know, hashtag also Real Men Love Tangled.
Yeah.
And of course, that would have gone for either of these songs, I guess, so whatever. I did pick I See the Light, and that is what advanced easily easily I see the light advanced onto the second round. Good and that deal. Will square off against Reflection in the next round. Moving on to the live action films portion, the number one seed Strong from the live action Cinderella film versus the number eight seed What's My Name from, of course, the Descendants franchise. Michelle, who did you pick in that one?
I had to go with the classical Disney kind of style song and went with Strong.
That is where I went as well, and that is what, in a really close matchup, went on in advance. Strong went on to the second round. And Strong will square off against the winner of the four seed versus the five seed. The four seed is That's How You Know from, of course, Enchanted versus the five seed Just Like Fire from Alice Through the Looking Glass. That movie kind of went by the wayside. It almost went by the wayside in my brain there.
Yeah.
So, Michelle, who did you pick in that one?
I went with the underdog there, the Just Like Fire.
Yeah, sung by Pink. Really good song.
That's awesome.
But it did not beat That's How You Know, which was my selection, but a lot of people picked that song, which I think more people knew that song.
Yes.
More people have seen that movie, love that movie.
Right.
More than Alice Through the Looking Glass, let's be honest. So I think that's why that advanced.
Sure.
That will go up against Strong in the second round. Moving on to the next portion of the bracket, the third seed versus the sixth seed. The third seed is Man or Muppet from The Muppets versus the sixth seed, The Climb, from, of course, Hannah Montana. Michelle, who did you pick there?
That was tough because those are both really, really great.
It was a tough one. It was a tough one for me as well.
Yeah, yeah. And I think on different days I would have picked different songs, but I picked Man or Muppet.
Right. I really fell in love with The Climb more recently. I just think it's such a wonderful song, as we discussed in that episode where we went through the first round a couple shows ago. But it did not advance. It got a few votes for myself and some others, but Man or Muppet is what advances on, and deservedly so. It's a great song. So it will square off against either Santa Fe, the two seed, or Are We Dancing from The Happiest Millionaire, number seven. The Santa Fe is from Newsies, of course. Michelle, who did you pick there?
I picked Are We Dancing.
And I picked Santa Fe, and that's what moves on. You weren't the only one to pick Are We Dancing, so just be happy that, because that was a rather obscure song, but there were others that liked that song as well.
Good, good. So, and hopefully it makes people, again, try different things that are on Disney Plus.
Yes, yes, for sure. So it's good that we got something from The Happiest Millionaire.
It's quirky.
It's classic song. Classic song, for sure. So finally, we finish it up with the heart songs portion of the bracket. We'll start with the animated films. And the number one seed, Baby Mine, versus the eighth seed, You'll Be in My Heart. Michelle, who you got?
I picked Baby Mine.
That's who I picked as well. And that's who barely advanced. This was another really close one. It was like a one vote difference that moved them on. So Baby Mine does advance to the second round. So it will go up against either the fourth seed or the fifth seed. The fourth seed being When She Loved Me from, of course, Toy Story 2 versus Your Heart Will Lead You Home from the Tigger movie at the fifth seed. Michelle, who'd you pick?
I know that my selection isn't going to win, but I couldn't avoid putting it on my bracket is Your Heart Will Lead You Home.
It is a great song. I get it. When She Loved Me, however, did advance. That was my pick. That's who advanced, because I think more people know that song, but both great songs and both deservedly could have advanced to the next round.
Right.
At the third seed, we have Dos Oruguitas versus the sixth seed, Goodbye May Seem Forever. Michelle, who'd you pick?
Again, two great songs going up against each other, and I think that I picked differently than you. But thinking of heart song, they're both heart songs, but I picked Goodbye May Seem Forever.
Yeah, I get it. I get it. I can't pick that song because it wrecks me. So I couldn't pick that song. And I love Dos Oruguitas.
Right.
Hashtag real men love Encanto. Right. And that is what advanced. I think, again, more people know that song.
Sure.
It doesn't surprise me that one advances.
Right.
Encanto, very hot right now. So Dos Oruguitas did advance. And that goes up against the two seed or the seventh seed. The two seed being Remember Me from Coco versus Out There, the seventh seed from The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Michelle, who'd you pick?
Well, I think in this one, you probably felt like Out There should have been a much higher seed than it was. But I did pick Remember Me, the Miguel version from Coco.
Yes, I don't blame you for that. It's a great song. I did pick Out There, the seventh seed. I wish it had a different matchup because it might have gone further, but it didn't go on any further because it was such a tough matchup against Remember Me.
Right.
And Remember Me does advance and will square off against Dos Oruguitas in the second round. Mm-hmm. Finally, wrapping it up with the live action version of the Heart Songs, the one seed Evermore versus the eighth seed Seize the Day from Newsies, Evermore being from the live action Beauty and the Beast. Michelle, who you got?
Kind of with the number one there, Evermore.
Yeah, that's who I got too, and that's who advances. Mm-hmm. Evermore did make it to the second round. Again, a relatively close battle in that one.
So really?
That
was
a little, yeah, Seize the Day did pretty well.
That is a great song.
Yeah, for sure. So that it will go up against the winner of the fourth seed versus the fifth seed. The fourth seed being How Does a Moment Last Forever, again, from the live-action Beauty and the Beast, versus the fifth seed Speechless from the live-action Aladdin. Michelle, who'd you pick there?
I went with How Does a Moment Last Forever when I did my bracket, but either day, on another day, I could have gone the other way, but that's the one I picked.
Yeah, I get it. I love Speechless. Speechless is one of my favorite newer songs out of the live action films. And I think more people knew Speechless. Mm-hmm. Speechless did move on. But again, relatively close battle.
Yeah, yeah. So, that one was a toughie.
So, yeah, so it'll be Speechless versus Evermore in the next round. Finally, the number three seed, Fall on Me from the Nutcracker and the Four Realms. Mm-hmm. I can see why this one might have gone by the wayside, versus Where the Lost Things Go, the number six seed from Mary Poppins Returns. Who you got there, Michelle?
I went with Fall on Me. That song is just too amazing. I mean, especially by who it's performing it and everything. So that's the song I went with.
I went with Fall on Me as well, and we were both in the minority with that one, unfortunately, because it is such a great song in a not very good movie, but it is a really, really wonderful song. Where the Lost Things Go does advance, and that doesn't surprise me, to be honest with you. It's another great song, too.
Yeah, it is. It's definitely a good song. I mean, I think it's one of those that's super emotional of a message and everything.
For sure. Get it. Finally, Feed the Birds, the number two seed versus the seventh seed, Nobody Knows from the live action Pete's Dragon. Michelle, who'd you get there?
You know, I would have I feel a little bad for not picking Nobody Knows because it's just beautiful. But Feed the Birds, had to go with Feed the Birds.
Very nice. Yep, that's who I went with as well. And that's what pretty much everybody went with, was Feed the Birds. Mm-hmm. Great song, such a classic. Wouldn't surprise me if Feed the Birds goes very, very deep in this competition.
Right.
So Feed the Birds does move on to face off against Where the Lost Things Go in the second round. And of course, next week, like I said, we will have the winners of all these. Second round should take a little less time than today's did. But we will go through those as well next week. And that should be a lot of fun.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks again for people who participated in it and for the feedback.
Like I said, hopefully you're following along and you know how you're doing, because one of you is going to win that great prize back. So thank you again. Thanks everybody who's taking part in this, and I hope you're having some fun with it. And this won't be the last bracket we do, for sure.
Right.
So now it's time to move on to the Disney stories of the week. And I'm going to start with, if you love Disney Plus but are not crazy about the price of it, well, we have some good news for you. This from a Walt Disney Company press release. They say, in a first for Disney's premier direct-to-consumer streaming service, Disney Plus will expand its offerings to consumers by introducing an ad-supported subscription in addition to its option without ads, beginning in the U.S. in late 2022, with plans to expand internationally in 2023. So right now, your only option is you pay the full monthly price or the yearly price for Disney Plus.
Right.
You get no ads, which is great. Mm-hmm. That's fine. But maybe it's a little pricey for you. Now, if you don't mind sitting through an ad here and there, you can pay what is going to be a lower price and still get all this great Disney content.
Right. Yeah. I actually heard the announcement on CNBC. So it was like with the stock market news and stuff, and how this is really a great, you know, it's a great decision for the company, but it also then is awesome for the consumer as well.
Right. No word on what the price point will be on it yet, but most expect it to be somewhere around like $4.99 a month for the ad-focused one, but we'll find out later on.
Right.
We'll see. This was a quote from the press release. It said, quote, "Expanding access to Disney Plus to a broader audience at a lower price point is a win for everyone, consumers, advertisers, and our storytellers." This from Kareem Daniel, chairman of Disney Media and Entertainment Distribution. He went on to say more consumers will be able to access our amazing content, advertisers will be able to reach a wider audience, and our storytellers will be able to share their incredible work with more fans and families, end quote. So like you said, it's a win definitely for the Disney company, but also for people as well. And look, for the Disney company, the fact that they can now sell Disney Plus to advertisers is a big deal. We've seen Disney Plus's subscription growing. Maybe it slowed down a little bit from what it was early on, but it still was doing better than expectations when they launched that service. So there have to be some advertisers that kind of want to get their message out to all these people that, you know, visit Disney Plus.
Right. Yeah. Actually, one of the things that I had heard is that advertisers were the ones really kind of promoting that concept to the Disney company, feeling like that would be a great way that they could reach their audience for ads, and that it could be more suited for that audience, you know, like they could more target than what they've done on regular cables and stuff like that.
Right. So, I mean, you know, it's just, it seems like it's a win-win for everybody here. It's a win for Disney in the fact that, one, they can put out their products for people that may not be able to afford it right now. They can get these revenue from these advertisers. The advertisers, meanwhile, get to put in their stuff and get it in front of people that they want to in a different way. And for the consumer, yeah, you can have your choice now. You can pay the more and skip all the commercials, or you can pay a little less and, you know, and have a commercial here and there, but still get all that wonderful Disney content.
Right. And to have that influx of revenue for the company is to keep good content coming onto the service. So.
So that was great news. I thought that was a big thing this week for sure.
Most definitely.
Most definitely. So moving on to our next story. If you have little ones at home that are big fans of Disney Junior, well, there's a Disneyland event coming you're going to want to know about for sure and start planning, because this from the Disney Parks blog, they say, all right, families with young ones, get ready to party. The first ever Disney Junior Fun Fest, a one-day event celebrating the entertainment and music-filled stories of the number one preschool television network's hit series, will bring the magic straight to fans at Disney California Adventure Park from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. Pacific Time on Friday, April 29th. 2022. That sounds like it's going to be a lot of fun if you had the little ones around that love these shows and these characters.
Right. I think it's brilliant that they're doing this and provide that opportunity. I think, you know, it all touches and supports what the company is offering, but it's also something more unique that it's actually addressing the younger audience. I mean, I think there's been a lot, obviously, for different type of themed like a food and wine festival or whatever, more for adults and things, and to have something focused more on younger kids is really special.
Right. I wish they were doing it more than one day. I mean, I wish they'd have like a week, like one day a week for 4 weeks or something that they were doing this or something along those lines, because it would really open it up for more people. But at least it's a start. They can take a look at it, see how it does, how people enjoy it. And then maybe the next year they advance it, or maybe they do it more often or something like
that. Right, right. Yeah. Give them a chance to try something and then get feedback from people of how it went.
Right. And there's no extra price on what on top of your regular Disneyland ticket for this. And, you know, you have to obviously get a park reservation for Disney California Adventure Park that day, have a ticket for that day. But it does sound really cool. They went on to say in the story, the one-day event will include sneak peeks at upcoming Disney Junior series, special announcements, surprise appearances, a Doc McStuffins stage show highlighting 10 years of the beloved series, plus the Alice's Wonderland Bakery unbirthday party, a hands-on cupcake decorating course inspired by the new Disney Junior series. We talked about that a few weeks ago. We were talking about some of these special events, things that are going on in that included in the food and wine festival that we were just talking about a little bit ago. They also went on to say it all kicks off in the morning with a cavalcade of beloved Disney Junior characters welcoming fans and making their way through the park. Throughout the day, there will be main stage attractions with fun games, trivia, and music to keep preschoolers and their families singing and dancing together. You can also enjoy regular Disney Junior programming at Disney California Adventure Park, including the Disney Junior Dance Party and the Spidey and His Amazing Friends photo wall at the Hollywood backlot. So, yeah, so glad. I mean, Disney California Adventure Park has never been really the park for the younger ones, but they've always had that. Well, not always, but as of the last several years, they've always had that theater where they had kind of the shows that celebrated some of the Disney Junior shows. I'm glad that they're, you know, keeping that going.
That's
here
right.
in this park.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And giving, you know, giving the kids a little bit more involvement of fun things for them during the day.
Yeah. So, more reason to get out to Disney California Adventure Park for sure.
Yeah, exactly.
Finally, my last story is if you have a Disney cruise on the horizon, well, there's a key change to their COVID policy that you'll need to be aware of for the future. This is just kind of following suit with what's going on right now everywhere that we speak of. This from the Disney Cruise Line blog. He says that on Thursday, Disney Cruise Line announced a change to their onboard mask requirements for sailings departing from the United States following recently updated guidance from the U.S. Centers for Disease Control, the CDC and Prevention. Disney Cruise Line will be updating their face mask covering requirements beginning on March 11th. So from then on, face coverings on Disney Cruise Line ships will become optional in most indoor locations throughout the ships, the Walt Disney Theater being the primary location where they'll still be required. Right. So if you're just, you know, if you have a Disney cruise planned, and you're indoors and you don't feel the need to wear a mask, as of March 11th, you will not be required to do so. If you still want to wear a mask, as we would probably do, that's still fine with you. You still can do that. There's nothing wrong with wearing a mask. It is your choice on what you want to do.
They are still doing the requirements, though, for people to be vaccinated to get on the ship, et cetera, and the testing at port. So those other measures are still in place.
Yes, that's still correct. You will still have to be vaccinated to get on board the ship. You will still have to test before you get on board. But once you get on the ship, it was already okay if you're on the outdoor decks that you could not, you didn't have to wear a mask. Now indoor, except for, like I said, in the Walt Disney Theater, you will not have to be. There'll be probably a couple other places where you will have to wear a mask, but most locations on the ship now, that is up to your decision.
Right.
Yeah. They do say that guests under 5 years of age who are currently ineligible to be vaccinated will be required to wear face coverings in youth activity spaces and in the Bibbidi Bobbidi Boutique. And while not required, they say they continue to strongly recommend these guests wear a face covering in all other indoor locations.
Right.
And they also say that face coverings may be required in ports of call based on local government requirements, including in some of the areas at Disney Castaway Key. Masks should also be worn in the cruise terminal during the boarding and screening process, as well as during disembarkation. So still bring your mask with you. Don't think that you won't have to bring a mask, or you won't have to wear it at certain points. But obviously the requirements are significantly loosened.
Exactly.
So that's it for the Disney stories of the week. However, we never leave you without giving you some sort of tip that might help you on your next vacation. And when we do this, we always start with Michelle. One, because she's wonderful, awesome, all things great in the world. She does the best research. You heard it earlier. She has the best lists, but she definitely has the very best tips. So let's get to it. Here is Michelle's tip of the week.
Okay, my tip this week is going to be very short, because I think we've talked a lot again, especially when it's come to food, we talk a lot. But so if you're staying at a Disney resort, one of the things that is really helpful is to take a picture of their activity board list. It's usually in the lobby or near the lobby, like by the entrance or whatever, because these things do change from month to month, you know, or seasonally. But it's something I think that not everybody always remembers, that there are activities that are offered at the resort for the resort guests. I mean, some things are standard at all of them, like, you know, movies under the stars and things like that. But a lot of times they'll have activities themed with the hotel theme. And you want to make sure you take advantage of that.
Yeah, you really get a lot of that at the Animal Kingdom Lodge. I know they have a lot of interesting things that are involved around animals there that are kind of, you know, edutainment while you're staying there.
Exactly.
That is something you would definitely want to bring, especially if your little ones love animals and want to learn more about them. That's a great way to do it.
Right. And so they do try to have them, you know, like you're saying, that one's themed to Animal Kingdom. You know, the Polly has some things with luau dancing and things like that. So, I mean, take advantage of that. You're in a very special place and you can have a unique experience that doesn't necessarily include going into the parks.
Right. That's a great point. And Michelle's tip, always the best tip. And this is a really good tip. Really. I mean, you know, obviously when you're at Walt Disney World or even Disneyland, when you're at the resorts, you do want to go to the parks several times. But take advantage of those things that those resorts offer. You're paying a premium price to stay at those resorts. And they have a lot of great things for you to do there that you can decide said, this is for me, this isn't for me, but you know, maybe the days that, you know, I'm a little worn out from going to the parks, but I want to entertain the little ones especially.
Yeah.
These are great ways to do it.
Right. And sometimes they're just, you know, they're very short, you know, they don't take a long time or whatever. They could be arts and crafts. And, you know, sometimes it's involving, like at a vacation club resort that has a community house to have some activities there. But, you know, I know that because you're not getting that handout that you used to get like on check-in and or in your room or something like that, that you may forget that those things are still being offered. And but you could take a picture of it and have that ready available to you.
Yeah, very nice.
Thank you.
Love it. Great tip. Michelle's tip. Always the best tip. My tip for this week. Well, actually, I have two tips for this week. Ooh. And I'm going to start with the real tip. My first tip is just a quick reminder about advanced dining reservations for the Walt Disney World Resort. Mm-hmm. I think sometimes we need to have a refresher on that because things have changed a little bit over the years. If you haven't been in a while, you may want to know that what's going on with right. it right now. Just to let you know, they used to be out much more in advance. Now they're available 60 days before your vacation mm-hmm. for everyone staying there. Well, that's for everyone, actually. If you have a vacation planned, you can go book. It doesn't matter if you're staying on resort property or not. You can book 60 days mm-hmm. out
right.
On these reservations. If you're staying at a Walt Disney World resort, you can also make that 60 days out from the day you check in. That doesn't mean that you have to actually be in a park that day, the first day you get in. It's just the day that you would check into your resorts. Let's say you're flying in the late afternoon or evening right. and checking in that night. You can still, as long as your check-in is that date, you can still start making your reservations for your entire vacation as of that point. So if you're trying to get spots for some of the more highly sought after restaurants, what a good plan is, and we've gone over this several times during our tips, mm-hmm. is to make those later on for your vacation, since right. you can start making them on the first day of your stay.
Right.
And other people may have already made those for the later days in their stay, or that's the first day that's opened up for them. Some of those, like Space 220 and, you know, right. Be Our Guest, some of the more popular ones may be tougher to find, Sci-Fi Dine-In, et cetera, Olga's Cantina. So if you can plot those out for later on during your stay, make right. those reservations as soon as they become available, which is 6 a.m. Eastern time. So mm-hmm. if you're in the West Coast, it's really tough to get those times.
Right.
But if you're on the East Coast, it still is tough, 6 a.m. But it's a little bit more reasonable time for
right.
you.
Right.
Start jumping on that as immediately as soon as you can and get those tough ones first. And then you can start getting some of the other ones that maybe are a little bit easier to establish. Now, if you don't get to your, even that, you may still have trouble getting some of these reservations. Keep an eye out on there. Every once in a while, go back regularly to check on the reservations because right. people's plans change all the time. They're dropping reservations right. regularly. So if you can keep an eye on it, you never know when that restaurant might be available, especially as you get really, really close to it, like within a day of it.
Right.
Because when people realize that they're going to actually have to pay if they can't make right. it, then their plans change significantly. That's when they start dumping a lot of those reservations. And if you still don't get in then, try checking in through the My Disney Experience app. They have a lot of standby lists available,
right.
especially early in the day, that you can check in there. And if there a spot becomes available for you, they will call you
right.
and you can go. And so, and worst comes to worst, it can't hurt to go up actually to the restaurant itself and ask and see if there's anything available or if they'll put your name on a list there as
right.
well.
Right, especially earlier in the day.
Yes. And check back. Sometimes things open up, you know, they may say that their check-in is closed, you right. know, but every once in a while, things will open up again. So check sure. back from time to time. It can't hurt. Now for my second tip, and this is only because I've been being badgered by these guys that they want me to mention them. We have not been mentioning them enough during our show. And so I'm going to go ahead and appease them for one time this time. And that is that you should go and listen to the Conversations podcast, Pat and Charles. Yeah,
they have a podcast?
They have I'm not even sure if they know it from time to time, but every once in a while I do stumble across and it is very entertaining. It is a great Star Wars talk. They are a lot of fun. They are great guys. Even when they're badgering me, it's still fine. But they are so needy. I just wanted to make sure to get their name out there. Yes, the Conversation podcast. No, really. I'm having a lot of fun with them because
right.
they're good friends of ours. But really, they have a great show. If you love Star Wars or if you just love having a good time and laughing a lot, they have a really, really fun show. I know you agree because it's one of your favorite podcasts.
It is one of my favorite podcasts. It, you know, like if there's only one podcast I can listen to in a week, that would be the one. that I would pick.
Over ours, especially.
I know. It's so true. Well, they're really funny.
They are.
they're really great.
They're really good guys.
Yeah. And they do a great, great show. Love their shows. And it always is, to me, very eye-opening, like things that I didn't think I would even be interested in or care about, like how detailed some things are. And like, wow, that enriches the show, that or the movies or the series that much more, knowing that information.
Yeah, so definitely check them out. The Conversations podcast, all Star Wars talk. A lot of fun, great entertainment, fun guys. And there you go, guys, okay? Leave me alone. I got it out there for you. Just kidding. Love you guys.
I know. I did tell them we need to figure out a time to get them back on our show.
Yeah,
they're
we always have fun. You've probably heard them on our show. They're a good time for sure.
Yes.
So definitely check them out. That's it for this week. Next week, well, we're going to be looking at Disneyland through the eyes of someone who hasn't been in quite a long time. You know, there's been a lot of differences, a lot of changes, and actual new lands added. And of course, COVID policies have changed and everything. So we're going to be finding out more from this person as to what they experienced when they got to visit Disneyland again for the first time in forever.
Yes. Now, it's great. And it's great to be able to finally get the schedules up so that we could be able to do this interview. And I think people will be really happy, you know, just to get another perspective. I mean, I think we always talk about it because we go more frequently to things that, you know, we're talking as things open up, et cetera. But to hear an experience from somebody who hasn't been in a while, I think it's going
to
be great.
It's also always cool to see, you know, the Disneyland and the Disney parks in general through the eyes of a younger person.
Right.
As a younger person. And so just to see what they take in, because, you know, obviously, you know, we see things in a different way. We're adults. We've seen things through adult eyes. Mm-hmm. So, you know, sometimes the wonder of it all that's taken in by a younger person is always cool. It's a cool perspective to check out from time to time.
For sure.
So that's going to be a lot of fun next week, and we're looking forward to that. We appreciate that you joined us today. In the future, you can find us most everywhere you get podcasts. However, the very best place to find us is on our own website, HyperionAdventuresPodcast.com. And while you're there,
don't forget, you can sign up for the newsletter.
Please sign up for the newsletter. Just another great way to be involved in the Hyperion Adventures podcast world. Another excellent way is to follow us on social media. We're on Twitter at Hyperion Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, and Pinterest at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. If you are on Facebook, come on over and join us for some good, positive Disney energy fun on our Hyperion Adventurers Facebook group.
Yeah, we love the sharing and we love to celebrate with you. Mm-hmm. So.
A lot of fun out there just for some good, fun energy in the world, especially in the world of Facebook, but just in the world in general right now, which I think we all need.
So true.
Yeah. We're also on YouTube. If you want to see any of our videos there, just do a search for Hyperion Adventures Podcast, hit subscribe, and you'll know whenever we have a new one in that location. And if you ever want to contact us for any reason, please hit us up at our Gmail account, HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com.
If you ever have any questions about our episodes or have ideas that you want us to explore some things on, please don't hesitate to contact us.
Yeah, even if you just want to say hi. That's just, we love hearing from you. We love your input, whether it be through the brackets, whether it be on social media, whether it be an email account, whatever. We just love being in contact with you and sharing your input.
Exactly.
Yes. So that's it. Thank you for listening to another episode of the Hyperion Adventures Podcast. We look forward to sharing some time with you again next week. Until that time, I'm Tom.
I'm Michelle.
And we hope that you have a magical week.
Bye.